My name is Ed Boyden, and I direct the Synthetic Neurobiology Group and co-direct the MIT Center for Neurobiological Engineering. So one of our core motivations is that over a billion people around the world have sought some kind of treatment for a brain disorder. And if you look at the list, schizophrenia, addiction, Alzheimer's, you know, the epilepsy and Parkinson's and so forth, pretty much none of these disorders can be fully cured. And the treatments that do exist are somewhat partial and often have side effects. And so one of our goals is really to try to figure out how we can control the dynamics of the brain, not just to study the brain, but also to figure out where are the control knobs that we can dial information in to help people with brain disorders. And so one of our core motivations is to figure out, you know, why brain disorders are so different from other diseases, and can we actually repair the brain by repairing its computations? It's not enough to watch the brain in action. Because if, for example, imagine you're watching a computer and you see the screen and there's the actual processor. By watching the screen, you might think, wow, there's a lot of stuff going on there. But as we all know, a screen is a very passive part of the computer, right? It's just displaying information that's being computed elsewhere. And so if you want to understand how the brain works, you need to be able to turn on or off different parts of the brain and really test in a causal fashion how these circuits are computing. And so that's what we've been working on. So how do we control neurons in the brain? Well, neurons, to first order, compute using electricity. And one idea might be, well, let's just put a wire in and drive electricity in the brain, right? But there's a problem. Electricity goes everywhere. And so you can't turn on or off just the cells you want to. And that's why, for example, if something electronic falls into a bathtub, you know, that's dangerous. Electricity goes everywhere. So what we want is to use light, because light can be aimed. And of course, light is fast enough to keep up brain activity. And so what we want to do is to basically use beams of light to turn on or off different cells in the brain. Now, of course, most neurons do not respond to light, which is a good thing. But what we want to do then is basically to put molecules into neurons that convert light into electricity. And then aiming light at those cells will turn them on or off. It turns out that those molecules are found all over the place. That's kind of how photosynthesis in some organisms work. So we take these photosynthetic or sometimes photosensory molecules from single-cell prokaryotes and single-celled algae and other microbes, and we can put them into neurons, and now we put these molecules in that convert light into electricity. Neurons compute using electricity, and that's our goal. Thousands of groups are using optogenetics to study the brain, and an increasing number of groups are also trying to use optogenetics as a potential therapeutic for fixing the brain. I'll give you a few examples. Some of the molecules that we have been putting into neurons, when you shine light on the neurons become activated. And so you can try to figure out what behaviors or pathologies or other states of the brain driving those neurons will result in. I'll give you an example. A group at Caltech found a tiny cluster of cells deep in the brain of mice. And if you shine light on those neurons and turn them on, it actually causes aggression or violence. So you can actually find neurons in the brain that can trigger something very complicated and a behavior that many of us, of course, are interested in psychology and neuroscience because of its importance in society and understanding things ranging from, you know, free will to how the criminal justice system might work someday. There are groups using our technology to study how epileptic seizures occur. Now, in a seizure, many of the neurons in certain parts of the brain will be overactive. And so if you can shine light on those cells and turn them off, calming down that overactivity, you might be able to not only figure out how seizures happen, but maybe build a new kind of prosthetic that you can use to control the seizures. And a group at UC Irvine actually has been using some of the molecules that we've been developing over the years to actually drive and shut down different neurons to figure out how they can calm down seizures. I'll give you a third example. So there are millions of patients around the world who have forms of blindness where they've lost the photoreceptor cells in the eye, the light capturing cells. And so in such cases, those cells are gone, and so it's hard to imagine how you'd build a drug that would, you know, repair the cells because they're not there anymore. On the other hand, you can take our light-sensitive molecules, install them using technologies from the field of gene therapy in spared cells in the eye, and convert the rest of the eye back into a virtual camera. I think the frontier is really to figure out how we can control individual cells now, not just turning on or off sets of cells, but can we dial in complex patterns of information in three-dimensional neural networks? Can we play back an ensemble of activity that might happen when somebody or an animal, let's say, sees a car or a face? And then if you play back that complex pattern, is that enough to really drive the information into the brain? Or does that mean, if it's not complete, that other regions of the brain are contributing to those codes? And so that's, I think, one of the highest priorities for the next couple of years from the science standpoint.